Hi guys, the YouTube algorithm demands a sacrifice. If you enjoy my channel, please click the like button. It helps the YouTube algorithm see my videos and notify people when I upload. In Dan Simmons' Hyperion Cantos, the world of Hyperion is one of the 9 labyrinthine worlds. Each of the labyrinthine worlds contains a series of complex tunnels beneath its surface. These mysterious tunnels are more than 750,000 years old. They had been there long before mankind ever set foot on these worlds. Virtually nothing is known about the constructors of these tunnels. The ancient race, whoever they may have been, were given the name the Builders by the humans of the hegemony. The first colonist arrived on the world of Hyperion more than 400 years before the start of the first book in the Hyperion Cantos. Among the colonists were the Bikura, though they were not called such at the time. These settlers were brought to the planet by way of conventional space travel. But the drop ship carrying them ended up crashing on the planet's surface. The surviving settlers took up residence in the mountainous area of the planet. They would eventually discover the secret of this world, the labyrinths. After exploring the labyrinths, the settlers eventually came into contact with a cross-shaped parasite, which they eventually gave the name the Cruciform. The Cruciform gave the settlers the power to resurrect after death. The parasite was somehow able to store its host DNA after bonding. When the host died, the parasite would restore the host's body as well as memories. But this was also a curse. Once bonded to the parasite, the host was also forever bonded to the area. The Bikura could not leave the mountainous region they inhabited. And also with each successive resurrection, mental capacity was diminished, and eventually the ability to reproduce was lost as well. They had no genitalia, and were devoid of sex entirely. This is how the settlers became the Bikura, the physically and mentally stunted humanoids that inhabited the cleft in the mountainous region of the Aquila continent. The facial features of the Bikura were said to resemble the genetic defects which were often associated with Down syndrome. 70 Bikura survived the initial crash landing on the world of Hyperion. Several centuries after this, the 67-year-old Jesuit priest, Paul Dure, would encounter the Bikura after being exiled to the Outcast world of Hyperion. The details of what happened to Father Dure on Hyperion are recounted by Father Hoyt during the beginning of the pilgrimage to Hyperion, which takes place in the first book in the series. Dure's fanatic loyalty to his faith had been the reason for his exile. He had attempted to create false evidence for a pre-human Christian society on the labyrinthine world of Armaghast. He had falsified archaeological records during his time researching the labyrinths of Armaghast. Hyperion was his punishment. Early on during his time on Hyperion, he had paired with a man named Took, who would be his guide to the high country of Hyperion. After weeks, they made it to their destination, the Cleft, where he had intended to set up an ethnological research center. The flame forest near the Cleft made it unreachable for most of the Hyperion year, and the region was believed to be uninhabited by most. But Father Dure knew of the Bikura, and intended to study them in the context of the retrograde cultural effects of their extreme isolation, over-adaptation, and inbreeding. 87 days into his exile on Hyperion, they set up camp on the gigantic, expansive cliff. Hyperion was not like Earth. Tectonically speaking, the planet was dead. Though it had oceans, the continents did not drift. The cleft was not formed by rushing water as the Grand Canyon of Earth had been, but instead had been caused by a weakening of the planet's crust through long periods of freezing and thawing throughout the billions of years of the world's existence. That combined with the flow of underground rivers led to the collapse that created the cleft. The cleft ran across the entirety of the mountainous region of the continent of Aquila. The cleft. I had almost forgotten our destination. This morning, stumbling through the fog, leaping from one wet rock to another alongside the widening stream, I took a leap to a final boulder, teetered there, regained my balance, and looked straight down above a waterfall that dropped almost 3,000 meters to mist, rock, and river far below. 88 days into his exile on Hyperion, his guide took is murdered. Dure discovered his body after leaving his tent one morning. His throat had been cut. There had been no sign of anyone else. Dure even climbed to a high boulder to search the area using binoculars. But there was no one, no trace of the murderer. Took had been no more than 4 meters from him during the time of his death, and yet Father Dure had heard nothing. The murderers cut his throat while he slept. I heard no cry. I did dream, however. Dreams of Simpha ministering to me during my fever. Dreams of cool hands touching my neck and chest, touching the crucifix I have worn since childhood. I stood over Took's body, staring at the wide dark circle where his blood had soaked into Hyperion's uncaring soil, and I shivered at the thought that the dream had been more than a dream, that the hands had touched me in the night. A week later, Father Dure finally encounters the Bikura, the people he had come to study. Outwardly, the Bikura showed no signs of aggression, and they did not carry weapons. They appeared to be androgynous, and all of them were bald. The people who had approached me so silently were short. None came higher than my shoulder, and swathed in roughly woven dark robes that covered them from neck to toe. When they moved, as some did now, they seemed to glide over the rough ground like wraiths. Father Dure was able to interpret the Bikura dialect using his comlog device. The Bikura referred to themselves as the 70. After studying them for more than a day, he finally asked them if they had been responsible for the death of his companion Took. The member of the group, which Dure believed to be the alpha of the group, spoke up in response. "We cut your companion's throat with sharpened stones and held him down and silent while he struggled. He died the true death."
"Why?"
I asked after a moment. My voice sounded as dry as a corn husk crumbling.
"Why did he die the true death?"
said Alpha, still not looking up. "Because all of his blood ran out and he stopped breathing."
"No," I said. "Why did you kill him?"
Alpha did not respond, but Betty, who may or may not have been female and Alpha's mate, looked up from her loom and said simply,
"To make him die."
"Why?"
Continually, their responses provided him with no insight as to why they had slain his guide. He began to wonder if his comm log had in fact not been working. Eventually, he was in a rage. He asked them directly why they had spared his life but not Tuck's. They all looked at him, but it was the Alpha that spoke.
"You cannot be killed because you cannot die," said Alpha. "You cannot die because you belong to the Cruciform and follow the way of the cross."
The Cruciform parasite that all of the Bikura possessed left the mark of the cross upon all those infected. The Bikura had spared Father Dure because they had mistaken his crucifix for the Cruciform. Eventually, the Bikura led Dure to a large space within the cleft, where a large cross had stood on an altar. The place was ancient and had been carved there by intelligent hands. Father Dure knew that the cross in the center must have been the Cruciform the Bikura worshipped, and he knew it had been there for thousands of years, long before humankind had ever found Hyperion, or even left Old Earth, even before the days in which Christ was said to have walked the earth. At first, he believed that he had stumbled by chance on something that could change everything, evidence of a pre-human Christian civilization. But he was wrong. The Bikura eventually realized that Dure was not actually of the Cruciform, as they were. "Those not of the Cruciform must die the true death," and her voice held the tone of complacent finality
common to oft-repeated formulae and religious litanies.
It took the Bikura 3 days to decide the fate of Father DeRay, though he did not know what they meant.
Finally, Alpha came close. "You will become of the Cruciform," he said softly. The Bikura led DeRay to the entrance to the Labyrinthes of Hyperion, and in the darkness of the Labyrinthes, Father DeRay came face to face with the legendary being known as the Strike. There came the slightest whisper of sound. No, not sound. A disturbance in the cool air, perhaps. And I turned in time to see something enter the chamber. The Bikura were still kneeling, their heads down, eyes lowered. I remained standing. My gaze never left the thing which moved among the kneeling Bikura.
So far, I've made 2 videos about the being known as the Strike. You can find those videos linked in the Hyperion playlist in the description below. The Strike is a malevolent being of immense power and ambiguous origin that resides solely on the world of Hyperion. At that moment, I must have moved or made a sound, for large red eyes turned my way, and I found myself hypnotized by the dance of light within the multifaceted prisms there. Not merely reflected light, but a fierce, blood-bright glow which seemed to burn within the creature's barbed skull and pulse in the terrible gem set where God meant eyes to be.
The Strike moved all around him, shifting through space and time. He could see his reflection distorted in the metallic body of the creature. He felt exaltation and fear. He could not move or breathe. He waited for the embrace of the Strike, but suddenly it was gone. The Bikura then placed a small cross-shaped item around his neck, a cruciform. The walls of the cave had been lined with them. It stopped glowing once it was removed from the walls of the place, and was cool to the touch. The Bikura told him that he would forever be of the cruciform, from this day forth. Dure did not understand the meaning until later, when he found that he could not remove it.
It lay there, as if it were part of my flesh. I pulled and scraped and tore at the thong until it snapped and fell away. I clawed at the cross-shaped lump on my chest. It did not come off. It was as if my flesh had sealed itself around the edges of the cruciform. Except for the scratches from my fingernails, there was no pain or physical sensation in the cruciform or surrounding flesh. Only sheer terror in my soul at the thought of this thing attached to me. After performing scans upon himself, he realized that what the Bikura had said to him had been true. He was in fact now truly of the cruciform. The scans indicated no invasion of foreign DNA. The cruciform, on his chest, read as being composed of familiar tissue. It was his own DNA. Dure eventually comes to discover the regenerative abilities of the cruciform. But even after weeks of studying, he was no closer to understanding how the parasite actually worked. He was being driven mad by the strangeness and the horror of it all. He wondered how long before he would become like the Bikura, sexless and simple. "There is no doubt that I have discovered the ultimate in stagnant human societies. The Bikura have realized the human dream of immortality and have paid for it with their humanity and their immortal souls." Eventually, Father Dure decides that he will leave the place. The flame forest usually made the way untraversable, but they were quiet this time of year. But Dure would soon discover that there was no way out for him. He was of the cruciform, and the cruciform would not let him leave. If he could only have walked for 3 weeks through the forest, he could have gotten through. But the further he got from the cleft, the greater his pain. "The cruciform will not let me go." The pain was like a heart attack that would not stop. Still, I staggered forward, stumbling and crawling through the ash. Eventually, I lost consciousness. When I came to, I was crawling towards the cleft.
No matter how many times he attempted the journey, he could not escape. After months of enduring this, Father Dure decides to kill himself. by penetrating deep into the flame forest. Father Dure was found again 8 years later. He climbed into a high flame tree and crucified himself. His left arm. He'd pounded the stake between the radius and the ulna. Missed veins, just like the goddamn Romans. The alloy spikes he had impaled through his body to crucify himself in the tree conducted currents through his body. He was being cooked continuously. He had been hanging there for 7 years, dying, living, and dying all over again, forever a part of the cruciform, living only to suffer, only to find momentary release in death. The cruciform, forcing him to live again, electricity surging through him every second of those 7 years. Flames, hunger, pain, death. But somehow the goddamn cruciform, leaching substance from the tree maybe, the air, what was left, rebuilding what it could, forcing it to live, to feel the pain over and over and over. It was Father Hoyt who had discovered Dure there in the tree. When he removed the pouch from the thing that had been Father Dure, the cruciform fell from his body. Dure raised his head and smiled before finally dying truly. Soon after, the Bikura were butchered and the area was nuked. But the cruciform lived on. It had attached itself to Father Hoyt. Only the consumption of incredibly powerful painkillers kept him from feeling the intense pain caused by being away from the cleft. Still, every day for him was a struggle. I'd like to dive more into the cruciform and its connection with the strike in other videos. In the meantime, if you want to learn more about the Hyperion series, you can check out my Hyperion playlist linked in the description. Thank you guys so much for watching.